the fan this football season on Twitter and Instagram. You could win $100 in gas money thanks to your local Chevy dealers. One winner chosen every single Friday. Brought to you by your select Heartland Chevy dealers. Find new roads.
There's not a street that you can walk. You've got to watch just who you're talking to. They're out to get you.
So, turn your back on a is it... Virtually, you got access to the greatest researchers, sports researchers in the world. Is it, what's the percentage right now on the Minnesota Vikings making the postseason? I'm guessing, before you tell me, it's over 80%.
No, they have them at 66%.
Really?
And but if they even if they lose to the Bengals, they're down, it'll still be 51-52%.
Only AFC, because AFC loss?
I guess. Why? Yeah, that's part of it.
Maybe.
And also that everyone else in the NFC is losing.
Yes.
So it doesn't, at least has lost in the past few weeks. So they have managed to stay ahead.
So how many games do we have to win? We got four left.
Yeah.
Starting with Cincinnati on Saturday, noon game. You going on this one?
I will be there. No, I'll be there. Yeah.
Okay. How many do we have to win?
At least two, I think. And maybe three.
You've given up on the division, even though I know we control our own destiny, correct or no?
Yes. If the Vikings win the rest of their games, they'll win the division.
But have you given up on that? Even if it's still feasible, you know, can be done. Are you saying it's not going to happen?
It's a very small percentage.
Right.
And like that would, I think our researchers are giving that a 16% chance of happening.
16%?
16%.
But, I mean, the Bengals now, they're using a backup, Browning, who's actually emerged a little bit,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he's been good.
Is he, though, is it like, it's going to be the same with him as if all the rest of the backups? Yeah, he looked good for a couple weeks, but now he's going to come back to the pack because none of these guys are that good.
And like, I hate to keep harping on this, but like, we're at the point in the season where we've seen enough of the Flores defense that I think he's going to struggle with it. Like that's the whole point of the Flores defense is to take away some of the things that the quarterback and the play caller like to do and then confuse them on what's coming in all the other times. And so there's that, I mean, if he manages to have a really good game against the way the Vikings play, then that's, you know, kudos to him. And I'm not saying it can't happen, but like, Joe Burrow would probably not have his best game of the year against these guys. And if you're a Vikings fan and, you know, we spend the whole time talking about who's going to play quarterback. If you're hoping that they win this game, you know, it's likely going to be, certainly an insignificant
13-10 kind of game.
It's going to be very much on the back of the defense.
So you're going to have to, you can't keep mocking low scoring games. It's not going to be 3-0 again though, is it?
This is an outdoor game. I don't think they're expecting bad weather, but this is the type of time of year when those kind of games happen.
We're a top 5 defense in points allowed now.
Everything. Whatever the stat is, you know.
I mean, right. It really is. Now, again, I know lately you could say who have we played.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't totally disagree with that, but
it's been going
at some
on
point
long
it doesn't
enough.
Matter.
It's been
yeah,
going
right.
on long enough. And I think, you know, and sometimes when you watch every game and you say, well, that on that play, if he hadn't done this, like they would have had a 70-yard touchdown. So you can always kind of pick that out.
Right.
But if you aren't, like, if you watch every single play do you even have the opportunity to say that. People watching the Vikings defense from the outside are just giving it all kinds of kudos and all kinds of, I can't believe how much they've accomplished in such a short period of time, and have great respect for the level of defense that they're playing.
We gave up last year on average 25.1. We're at 18.6 now. That's a touchdown.
Yeah.
A game.
Yeah, that's what I said, 180 degree difference.
It's
from
remarkable.
It's not just playing style, but performance too. And again, with largely the same players.
Is Marcus Davenport still alive is what Willow Mark Rosen's cat asks.
I saw him yesterday. He was in the locker room.
Mark Rosen's cat or Davenport?
No, Marcus Davenport for sure. We asked a couple weeks ago if Davenport was going to, they were going to open the window to get him back in practice, and he O'Connell didn't rule it out. I haven't asked lately. It doesn't, you know, it certainly didn't happen this week, and I think he's eligible already.
What other injuries do we need to talk about? Jefferson's going to play.
Yeah, Jefferson is fine.
Explain to me how a shot to his lower back becomes a chest injury, first of all. Are we playing some sort of a semantical game here to protect him in the hockey tradition?
Yeah, I I asked Stefania Bell that, our you know, she's our medical expert that appears on all the TV ESPN shows, and she said that it actually, from medical sense, can make sense because you can be hit in the back and the side and all that. The ribs are it's all connected. It didn't strike her, and she is there for in large part to try to decipher the propaganda and the noise and tell us exactly what's going on. And it did not strike her as misleading or unlikely, even that a shot to the back, and he grabs his back too, like in the kidney area. Yes. And that's, I thought that's what they were checking was the kidney. He said today that
I was assuming internal bleeding.
Yeah,
in the hospital.
Yeah, and he did say that. Like he said that among the things they checked for was internal bleeding and broken ribs,
ruptured spleen.
He didn't say that, but like if you have a broken rib, then you're worried about punctured lungs.
That's true. And
Stefania said that could be one of the things they probably looked at. So all that kind of stuff. And he said that he never had a hard time like taking deep breaths or anything. So they kind of felt okay about his lungs, but they wanted to check everything. And so I had the same suspicion. It doesn't like make visual sense when you see a guy grab his back and all of a sudden it's described as a chest, but apparently no shenanigans.
We blame it on Dobbs.
Yeah. I mean,
high throw, left him vulnerable.
And also, it's not the
timing?
First time. Yeah. Well, no, I just say, like, a lot of times, sometimes you'll see a pass like that, and the guy has to jump and expose himself, and nobody hits him. You know, it's a little bit of chance, too. I mean, the Raiders safety, Marcus Epps, had to be there also and had to be willing to give him that shot. And, you know, and that there could have been a lot of other outcomes, even with that type of throw. But yes, you would like to see him make that throw. Lower and away from the defender.
Have you talked with anybody? Because I don't think you and I have talked about it regarding the bleep me moment involving the head coach. And it was a successful first down, a scramble for a first down by Dobbs. The camera pans to the Vikings sidelines, and the head coach can be very clearly seen. You didn't have to be a great lip reader saying bleep me like he was frustrated, like there was something he thought could have been had, I'm assuming, as a pass play in that situation that wasn't. Did you guys drill him on that?
He did mention at one point that I think if someone mentioned there was a play where Hockenson was open at one point early in the game. But nobody, I was watching the game on TV and I didn't notice that particular moment. So no one asked him directly. And you know, there, as the play caller, I'm sure there's lots of times in every game where you wish the quarterback had seen something. There's a lot of times with Kirk when people were there and he didn't make the throw for whatever reason.
Madison, what's his injury status?
Yeah, he hasn't practiced yesterday or today.
He's looked good.
Yeah, he had, he's the past few games, he looked good. You know, one of the tweaks they did do with Dobbs in the lineup was go to more of sort of the read option. And so when there was the threat of Dobbs running, he really didn't run it. But when there's a threat, like the theory goes, maybe Madison had a little bit more wiggle room there and he looked good, you know, popping it in there. But he has an ankle and, you know, short week and doesn't practice Tuesday, doesn't practice Wednesday. We'll see what he does tomorrow. But neither he nor Brian O'Neill have practiced either day. And so that... Potentially, Nick Mullins, have fun with a backup right tackle and your third string running back.
Are we mad at O'Neill? He dominated at times. Now, again, against one of the best defensive players, defensive linemen in the league.
Yeah.
But are we? I saw a couple of observations from Mark Craig in his 5 points that he does the day after games where he came down on him pretty good. Is O'Neill not playing all that well, and is he going to be available?
Second question, it doesn't look like he's... I mean, we have seen him walking around the facility, and he looks like he's walking okay, but if you're not out there practicing at all, even during like walkthroughs, then I guess it feels like it's unlikely that he would make that quick turn, but I guess we'll see. You know, when you have what you think is a really good... and definitely highly paid right tackle, and you would like to think that he could hold his own against, you could put him out there and say, okay, you know, have at it with Max Crosby. And I don't think he got beat on every play, but he got, you know, there were some high profile ones, including the one he got hurt on where he was. Yeah. And so even when you have a right tackle who's playing pretty well, or has a pretty good reputation, maybe you have to help him more. Maybe you have to give some tight end help or running back help or what have you. But no, that was certainly not his best game.
Well, is it possible bumper to bumper is the jinx? Madison comes on with us last week, hurt. O'Neal comes on with us later that same show, hurt. Mm. Jordan Hicks, still recovering, finally joined the show earlier in the week. Significant injury. I'm starting to worry, as superstitious as players are, that they're going to start peeling away from this program because they're going to blame us.
Well, now you got me worried.
Yeah.
I feel okay right now.
So far, so good.
Yeah.
Garzy somehow tried to implicate the show in your ankle injury last year. It's like, wow, that's pretty deep.
That would be retrofitting the argument for the circumstances. I've been on the show for decades.
That's
it. And I think that was my first time.
Well, that's a good point. That's a good comeback.
And that was my first time of surgery was required, at least.
Yeah. Anybody else we got to worry about injury-wise? That's it, right? Those are the main ones.
Yep. Yeah. Ed Engram. He's been back limited. We'll see if he comes back at guard or not, or if they go with another game with Blake Brandel. And I think those are the Chris Reed missed practice today because of an illness, but he's been a backup. So I think those are the main ones.
So NFC in general, everybody's losing that's behind us. Bears are coming.
Yeah.
But the NFC North looks weird at this point. And the Packers, they blew a great opportunity. They got an extra gift in that game and still found a way to lose it. So at this point, are you in the group that says you really can't take any of these teams in the NFC outside of San Fran, Dallas, if you buy them now?
No, I think Dallas
is
good.
And or Philly? Is that it? Is that the plateau?
I think it's right now, it's 49ers, Dallas, and everybody else. Like Philly is,
they're sliding a little bit.
They're sliding, okay. and it's, there's, not that this part matters, but it's been interesting how quickly their fan base has turned. There's been people calling, like standing at the entry of their facility, calling for people to get the defensive coordinator to get fired and
classic. Asking
them not to play Darius Slay. Like Darius Slay, pretty good player, right? Yeah, maybe had a few balls completed against him, but so that has gotten kind of poisonous pretty quickly, but they're probably the third best team. But that really right now it looks like the 49ers and Cowboys and everybody else.
And then we're as good or bad as any of them. The rest,
right?
It's just a mishmash.
Yeah, I mean, especially with the way the defense is playing. Yeah. Like I don't know if we're gonna look back and say like once the Dobbs mania ended that the offense just really kind of became punchless. Like, I don't know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. I mean, you would hope with Jefferson that it would, they have a chance to score some points, but these past two games have been rough.
Any last item, any chance the Lions-Vikings game gets flexed on Christmas Eve, or are we past the point of that sort of thing?
Yeah, I think it would have to be 12 days. Are we 12 days? I don't think that's
going to be. We're not 12 days yet.
Well,
are we? No, yeah, we are, because that game's 24. 24.
Yeah, I don't think it's getting flexed.
Not going to happen.
Yeah.
Good to see you. Thanks, as always. We'll chat next week.
Yes, sir.
Kevin Seifert, brought to you by Shane Company. We have, at the bottom of the hour, a Timberwolves point guard.
You can listen to the Fan.
Check out the Friday Football Feast this week at Buffalo Wild Wings in Roseville. Doors open at 8 ahead of a live 9 to noon broadcast, PA and Charge. Join us for football, wings, and prizes. Full list of dates and locations at KFAN.com. Keyword calendar.
Got a lot to get to with Kessler. That'll be coming up in studio at 5:30 this evening. I meant to get to this story yesterday. It's getting a lot of national A-section attention, as well it should. Let me read you a synopsis via the Texas Tribune. 2 weeks ago, Kate Cox sat at her OBGYN's office, anxiously awaiting the results of her amniocentesis test. She knew her fetus was developing with a twisted spine, clubbed feet, irregular skull, and heart development, and she'd gone to the emergency room 3 times in the last month for cramping, diarrhea, and unexplained fluid leakage. The amniocentesis confirmed her fetus was developing with full TRISOMY18, an extreme chromosomal abnormality. If her child was born alive at all, they would survive only minutes, hours, or days outside of the womb. Cox's pregnancy was going to end in heartbreak. The only question was when Cox
and her husband wanted to end, quote, the pain and suffering that has plagued this pregnancy. I do not want to put my body through the risks of continuing this pregnancy. I do not want to continue until my baby dies in my belly, or I have to deliver a stillborn baby, or one where life will be measured in hours or days, end quote. Before the overturn of Roe v. Wade in June 2022, Texas law would have allowed Cox to have an abortion at her doctor's office or hospital, but now her doctors told her they could not perform the procedure, and there was likely no one in Texas who would. While Cox was inside a doctor's office in Dallas receiving this devastating diagnosis, the Texas Supreme Court was considering the exact question of when and whether doctors can terminate a pregnancy in another case, Zerowski versus Texas. 20 women had signed on to that suit, saying they'd been unable to access medically necessary abortions because of the state's abortions laws. Texas laws ban abortions, all abortions, unless, quote, in the exercise of a reasonable medical judgment, end quote, a doctor determines that the patient is experiencing a life-threatening physical condition aggravated by, caused by, or arising from a pregnancy that places the female at risk of death or poses a significant, I should say, a serious risk of substantial impairment of a major body function. The Center for Reproductive Rights, which filed the Zerowski suit, argued doctors are unclear on what qualifies as reasonable medical judgment and should be allowed to act based on their good faith belief that an abortion was necessary. Initially, a judge in Austin agreed and enjoined the law as it applied to complicated pregnancies. The state appealed that ruling to the Texas Supreme Court, arguing in part that the plaintiffs didn't have standing to sue because they were not actively seeking abortions in Texas. And it goes on from there. Also, it's important to note that the state of Texas has made it clear that they won the case at the Supreme Court level, that Kate Cox should not be allowed or be able legally to pursue this merciful end to her suffering and her child's suffering. Abortion's a volatile subject, but I'd like to believe, by the way, there are a number of legal scholars who say that ultimately the Supreme Court may have ruled correctly on the basis of the laws that were passed by the legislature. And so I would argue, if you buy that premise, the venom, the vitriol, the savagery should be directly related to those individuals who passed laws this draconian. Do you have to be a hardcore pro-choice person, in all seriousness, to say this is sickening? That whatever your intent is regarding your approach on these issues, that this is the sort of case where only if, you don't have to deal with the pain and suffering involved, and often and likely are male, you could, with a straight face, sleep at night, depriving this poor woman of pursuing the course that she should have every right to pursue. Sickening case, pathetic outcome. And now she has the means to do it. She's going to have to go outside the state, and she'll be able to do it. But we've talked about this a lot, that especially since the Roe v. Wade decision came down, that there was, I think, a relatively reasonable middle ground that ruled the nation at that point, and that clearly has been lost. And the zeal with which the powers that be in the state of Texas pursue their right to defend the laws that the legislature put in place there. I lived in Texas for 5 years, and I actually had a pretty good time there. I sure as hell glad I'm not living there any longer. Absolutely pathetic, ridiculous, inexcusable situation. And you could say, well, these are the outliers. even if there's one outlier, if that's what you want to call this, the idea that she doesn't have the opportunity to do what she should have every right to do is breathtakingly embarrassing, pathetic.
Time presented by Miller Lite, official beer sponsor of the Minnesota Vikings. Vikings linebacker Jordan Hicks joins Barrero next. After this, from Miller KFAN, The Fan.
Kessler will join us in studio in the 5 o'clock hour, top 5 at 5, courtesy of Brett Blakemore, coming up in about 30 minutes. Minnesota Timberwolves will be back in action tomorrow night against the Dallas Mavericks on the road. And Mike Conley, kind enough to join us now via the Connecticut Water Systems hotline as well. Mr. Conley, thanks for the time as always. I want to start, if I can, with a bit of sound that you might have heard from the Timberwolves website, but that many of our listeners may not have. The question that was asked a number of Timberwolves players, actually, I think, including you, is who is the most popular Timberwolf with the head coach? I guess that'd be the best way to put it. And now I'm having trouble finding it on the page. Where'd you put it, Blakemore? Hold on 1 second and we'll get it. Has it disappeared on me? Are we on the, just hit it now if you can find it, because I can't find it.
Here Coach's favorite.
Coach's favorite. This is a crazy question y'all put in here.
I don't know if he has a favorite, but I guess if he had one, I guess I would say me.
It was 81 last year. It's 85 this year.
Probably Ant. I'm going Ant. Safe answer.
That's Ant, probably.
Who can she say is his favorite?
Either Ant or Mike. I say Ant or Mike.
Probably Mike Conley.
I don't know.
Mike Conley. I mean, who doesn't love Mike Conley? I think he's a teacher's pet.
Mike Conley. Gotta be Mike Conley. You don't do nothing wrong, so gotta be Coach's favorite.
Man, Luke Lugarza. Plead the fifth.
So I think it was you who picked Luka. You gave Luka a vote. Everybody, pretty much everybody else by the end of it was saying you. So do you plead guilty? Are you the teacher's pet? And is that a compliment, or do you take it as not so much of one? What do you think?
Yeah, I do take it as a compliment that I'm well received, but not the teacher's pet portion of it. I don't disagree with Coach on everything. I'm just, an easygoing guy to get along with. That's all.
So it sounds like you don't have any problem occasionally disagreeing. And I would assume, my assumption is, because of your years in the league and the position you're in an odd sort of way, it actually liberates you to being more honest without yelling, because it's pretty clear you're not a yelling guy all that much. You're not a screamer. That to a certain extent, that maybe makes it less challenging for you to say, no, I don't know why we're doing that, or I think we should do this instead of that.
Yeah, 100%. And, it's funny because I think Coach, he leans on me a lot for, he'll ask me questions as small as, what time should we get on the bus for practice for, on the road tomorrow or something like that. Like, mm-hmm. How are guys feeling? What's the pulse of the team? Like, I think he just trusts my input a lot, having been around a lot of different teams and a lot of different personalities, and helping them manage that. And it's good. It's good for our relationship as a coach and player to be able to be, openly honest and be able to just lay everything on the table whenever we need to.
No question about that. You guys lose to the Pelicans. It looked to me like there were stretches where you guys are having some, obviously Anthony didn't play. That you're having some stretches where you're having difficulty getting offense. And it may also have been a case of bad timing for you guys, because the Pelicans had just gotten destroyed in the in-season tournament and took all kinds of national abuse, man. Charles and company were just merciless on hammering them. And so you got to believe, human nature being what it was, they were, especially playing at home, we're going to come back with, okay, we've got to take some kind of a stand. How did you view it?
Yeah, we knew that they were going to be extra motivated, but that's part of the game, and we don't associate that as reason why we win or lose a game. But they definitely came out with something to prove. But with our case in general, we had obviously being with Ant being out, we played in one of, you know, some games this season without Ant, but adding Jaden back in the mix and, you know, trying to get guys, J-Mac back in the mix, like just a bunch of different, variables of, you know, trying to get people's timing and rhythm and groups together that haven't played together for the last few weeks. So, it was, you know, fairly, you know, kind of a new team for us going out there, just having guys in and out of lineup. So, it took us a minute to, you know, where we had those stretches where it was just, you know, the timing was off or, we weren't, you know, guys weren't always connected on certain different things. So, which was to be expected. And, you know, we ended up playing a team that was ready to go and, you know, had our number that night.
You are in an interesting stretch of games. I believe the stat I read was that, the Pelicans game was the start of 16 straight with teams that have, at least right now, better than 500 records, some of them gaudy records, a lot of those on the road. And, you know, I guess we can overdo the litmus test thing. You guys have gotten off to such a great start record-wise, but this is going to be a challenging stretch where I think you're going to learn a lot more, maybe the world's going to learn a lot more about the club, given the number of tough games that you have. And I would even submit to you the other challenge, and you've been on enough good teams to know this, when a team ascends and starts showing signs of what you guys were showing signs of, people pay attention and they start, you know, taking you more seriously. And guess what that means? They're going to challenge you more than, because you're now viewed as more of a threat maybe than you had been viewed before. All of that is part of the test coming up the next few weeks, correct?
It is. You know, there's a lot that goes into this, you know, having early season success. You know, teams, no matter how good or bad, you may feel your opponent may be for that night. They're coming out. They read the paper. They see what's going on. They see the records. They see how well the team's playing. They're going to come in and give you your best shot. And this is going to be a great test for us these next few weeks, just being able to play against such quality, you know, opponents. And I honestly think we play our best basketball in those games. So it'll be, you know, I think our guys will have no issues getting up for those games, competing and doing what we do and trying to continue the success we've had early on.
Are we close, you think, on Anthony? What's the feeling you're getting on him?
Yeah, I think we're getting close. I think he's, you know, he looked good today in practice. I think they're just going to wait and see. I don't know about, you know, what the plan is tomorrow, but sure. I know that he looked good today. So looking forward to getting him back out there as quickly as possible.
Well, one of the things that struck me about the game the other night, too, was, and I know Finchie had talked after the game, he was a little unsettled by the free throw disparity. And there were, it looked to me like, a few calls where I go, well, I'm not sure. On the other hand, it's looked to me like they were attacking the basket more than you guys were. And obviously, that's something that Ant does well, that you don't have that many guys. You certainly do it on occasion. You know, Cat can do it on occasion, although I thought in the second half did a good job of doubling him and making it really almost forcing him to give up the ball. You've talked about this before. I just hope this team never falls into the trap of settling for threes. It's in a big part of the game. You got to have it. You can't ignore it. But I like so much when you got guys attacking and trying to get to the free throw line.
Yeah, we, you know, the way our team is built, we're not built to, you know, hoist up 53s a game and play that game, you know, that a lot of teams can play this, you know, this day and age. But we have a great mix. And I think when we're utilizing our abilities to get to the paint, you know, dominate the paint offensively, and then also, you know, be efficient from the perimeter, I think it's when we're at our best. And like you said, that relies heavily on Ant and Kat and myself, a lot of guys making plays in the paint, you know, for our guys and trying to give ourselves the best, you know, best looks that we can get. And, you know, last game, I thought that they did a good job of offensively for them, just pushing the ball and trying to get in the paint. And once we got in foul trouble, you know, it's almost impossible to guard anybody. So they knew that, and they were, you know, Zion, those guys were just putting their head down and jumping into us, and not much we can do. Or you're going to pick up a fourth or fifth or sixth foul. So, you know, they kind of had the upper hand, and we just had a tough time recovering from it.
Timberwolves point guard Mike Conley joining us on the Fan. Kessler will be with us at about 5:30 in studio as well. I'm curious to get your view about a veteran player. It's one of the reasons we like having you on, because there's lots of issues that rear their head from time to time, and you got a good head on your shoulders. So, you know, Draymond got in trouble again last night. I don't even know if there's been a punishment assessed. You guys had your game with him earlier, and here's what's interesting to me. You know, there's a code in the league, it seems, that if a player is your teammate, you're kind of obligated. He's my guy. We're in this together, and so I have to defend him. But I'm wondering if there comes a point where it becomes hard to just, you know, look the other way or accept that. Because in Draymond's case, obviously, it's been incessant. There's already been two or three incidents this year. There have been some in the past, et cetera. So how do you, I'm sure you've played with players maybe sometimes who've perhaps gone over the line, and then you're in the position of, do I have to defend them? Should I defend them? What's your view? What's governed your own position, your own policies, when you find yourselves in that sort of situation?
Well, you know, I think, you know, it comes down to a lot of it, like, you know, the common sense stuff. Like, there's times when you get guys in a scuffle and you got to immediately take your teammate's side, you know, initially on everything, because it's what you do. And you don't know what happened before the incident happened. You just you go with your guy, and you support him through it, and you defend him. But there comes a time when, you know, it becomes really obvious of, like, hey, there's something else, you know, here. Something else is wrong. Like, I don't condone that. Like, we have to draw a line. Like, hey, we have to kind of condemn this kind of activity and say this isn't right. Like, we shouldn't, our guys shouldn't be doing this, as opposed to, you know, jumping in that hole and saying, you know, this is our guys, so we support them through this situation, but you still support them, but it's okay to also say, hey, that wasn't right. Like, he knows better, like, smarter than that, and move forward. So there's a balance to it, and it's just a matter of how what level violations are occurring, I think, for that person.
I have nothing but respect for the unique nature of Draymond Green over the course of his career. I have to believe he's one of the most unique talents in the history of the league, given what he can do at his height, his versatility, the importance he has, you know, been to that franchise during the dynasty years. But I got to tell you, at this point, there's no benefit of the doubt for me at this point with him. And I don't even know what the correct punishment is. And maybe you don't even want to weigh in on punishments, because it's another team. But it's wearying to me, because at some point you start saying, well, is everybody kind of enabling this guy on the basis of what he's been before? And at what point does the league start losing credibility if they don't really come down on him hard? Do you have a view on that at all?
Well, yeah, I think what you just stated is what's going through the minds of, you know, pretty much everybody who's been a fan of Draymond, or known him, or just seen his situations over the years, that it comes a point, and it might be to that point where, you know, we all got to look at each other and say, hey, you know, have we done enough, or what else is there to do for us, you know, going forward? Cause we can't continue to be, you know, going through this cycle over and over again. So, I'm sure the league, I'm pretty sure they're probably meeting the day about it, or the next couple of days about it. So I'm sure they'll come out with the right the right thing going forward. And you just want to see him. I like to see him on the court, man. He's one of the better players in our league, and for that team especially. Like, he makes a lot of things go and flow for the Golden State Warriors. So, you know, I'd rather see him out there than having to deal with this stuff.
So you're the guy who's known as never losing his cool. That is your reputation. You've earned that over, is it 17 years now? A long time. Yes, however long it's been. What is the closest you've ever come to being sort of, you know, losing your cool, blowing your cool, or getting into an altercation in a way that said, that's not me. That's not how I'm wired.
Ironically, it might have been with Draymond. it was the year in the playoffs. I had broke my face, like, the series before, so I had plates just put in I had surgery like a week before we played them. And so I came back a little bit early to suit up for like game two or whatever in Golden State, or three. I can't remember. I think it was two. And I had a mask on and I'm literally bleeding out of the corner of my eye and, you know, still a lot of blood on my face from surgery. And I get like a rebound and like ball falls on the ground and like I'm calling timeout and he like literally jumped and kind of like mushed across my face at the same time. And in my head, like I thought I was going to like get up and just go nuts. Everybody knew that I had broke my face, but at the time I was like, man, this, like I had to calm myself down so quick cause it was so painful. Like there were so many emotions going on. And, but that was probably the one time I was like, man, I almost like got up too quick and would have got a tech or something or did something. I don't know. I'm not saying I would have swung on anybody.
Yeah.
Anything,
right.
It wouldn't have been like me.
Did they call a foul on Draymond on the play? Do you remember?
No, I think they just gave me the timeout.
It
was like a play, you know, it was like a nothing play, but for me, it felt like it was like extra a little bit, you know what I'm saying? Right. So like it was like, and it's the playoffs too, so we already playing like that anyway, so it was just, you know, kind of one of those deals.
Did you say anything to him? Did he say anything to you?
I didn't say a word. I kept going. I think somebody might even ask me about it after the game.
Right.
I think it was a topic after. I think we won the game, and it was like I had to do media, and they asked me about, you know, what it, you know, what do you think about this? That play with Draymond, I was just like, man, it's whatever, man. We got the win, you know, just kept going forward.
Lastly, you got the Mavericks tomorrow night. I watched a decent amount of their game yesterday. Luka is a fascinating study because I don't think there is a single player in the league who complains more often to the refs. I'm a basketball guy, but I have a hard time watching it. And yet, who isn't going to put up with it? What team isn't going to put up with it, given how unbelievably influential a player he can be? I mean, he did pretty much everything in that ball game. And I don't know how often you're going to be in the position to have to guard him. I assume it's often going to be a group kind of thing. But what are the principles that guide you with a guy like that who is capable of doing the sorts of things we see him do on the court?
Man, he's so unique. And why he's so unique is because he's literally, quite frankly, probably one of the most talented players in our game on top of his IQ level of being able to manipulate plays. And then you add that into, you know, his ability to draw fouls or get your team in foul trouble. You know, and that kind of comes with the game of, you know, arguing with the ref, complaining and, you know, trying to get calls and stuff, you know, stuff like that. So for us, it's difficult because now you're trying to guard a guy who already is unguardable and, you know, you give him, you're a little worried about reaching or you're worried about putting the forearm on him because the ref's going to call a foul or some, you know, really tic-tac. So it becomes like, you know, ultra hard to guard. So, you know, with all those, you know, wheels in motion, man, he just makes, you know, so many plays and influences the game so much and just puts a lot of pressure on you as a defender.
Can you go at him at the other end? Offensively, can you guys, you know, is that part of what you almost have to do? You have to challenge him to guard?
Well, I think you do that with any high usage guy.
Yeah.
You know, with him, you know, you just don't want him resting. He's a guy that's going to play a lot of minutes, heavy minutes, and have a high usage. And for us, if there's any opportunity, we can obviously make him guard, make him move around, make him continue to use energy on both ends of the floor, just to make, you know, hopefully wear him down a little bit, or if you know, just get into his legs a little bit to where later in the game maybe it can affect him a little bit.
Last item, we had Tim Conley on the other day, and, you know, speaking of agitation, speaking of technical fouls, I think you guys led the league in tees last year, and I don't think you are anymore. The record is maybe not perfect, but to me, it looks like the message has been conveyed, and as you said, I think you told us, you know, Finchie may have set this down with the with calling as many technicals as he did in practice. But that, to me, it continues to be a really important part of this team's maturation is everybody gets into it with refs from time to time. There's a game that, to a certain extent, that probably has to be played. But it doesn't look to me as if that, you know, most of your guys, even Cat to a large degree, is quite as consumed as before.
Yeah, I think that has, you know, give Coach a lot of credit for that and the way that we've approached the year. But I think, for us to be a good team, we have to be disciplined. And that's a big part of it. Like, it's not being, not allowing a team to get back in the game because we're up 4 points and then we give up a technical and then get two technicals and now change the momentum and they get the ball and the game, swings in their favor just because we were upset about a bad call. Like, we have to be able to be, grown men and move on. And I thought we've done a great job of doing that so far this year. And, that could be, something that I think we'll continue to try to get better and continue to make note of. But been proud of the guys. Hopefully we continue to mature and make ourselves, give ourselves the best chance to be the best team we can be.
Good luck in Dallas, and we will talk again soon. Thanks as always, Mike.
All right, appreciate you.
Much appreciated. That is Mike Conley, the Timberwolves point guard, who's become kind of a semi-regular on the program. We've got Kessler coming in for the 5 o'clock, well, probably 5:30, he will start with us. We're going the distance today. It's a full show. We got Blake Moore, though, with the top 5 at 5, including, I'm guessing, some hockey.
There will be some hockey. We'll talk all of our favorite squads, and we'll discuss what the hell's happening.